Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and warm welcome to Heinrich Böll Foundation. We're very pleased that despite the approaching Easter festivities, this room has become quite crammed for a discussion on a topic that is not just on our minds, namely the relations between Serbia and Kosovo. How will they develop and what is developing here and how can life for the people of those countries be improved? We, at the moment, have a visitors group here in Berlin at the invitation of Heinrich Böll Foundation, led by the mayor of Pristina. And the group is looking into matters of sustainable town and city development. This is the topic of their study trip. We thought it's good to use this opportunity while we have the mayor to invite him to the panel and for him to speak, and not, of course, on his own, but with some interesting interlocutors the facilitator will present to you in a moment. The facilitator, and if you know Andreas Poltermann, you will see that this is not Andreas Poltermann. He fell sick very recently, but we are cooperating with the Southeast Society, and Tobias Flessenkemper took the place of Andreas swiftly and will support us in a hopefully very interesting discussion. Thank you very much, Gudrun. Good evening. I can't see whether everyone has really found a chair, but if there are still people in need of a seat, there are some chairs outside. Good evening to this discussion. Gudrun Fischer just said that we have gathered quite a high-ranking panel here, experts from the region, from the European environment, and from Germany on this topic. To my left, Spend Ahmeti, the mayor of Pristina. To my very direct left, Ulrike Lunacek, Vice President of the European Parliament and member to the European Parliament on behalf of the Greens from Austria. To my right, Tatjana Lazarevic of the Center for Community Development in North Kosovo, and Bodo Weber to the right. He comes from the Democratization Policy Council. I will ask the speakers to say a few words about their organizations and background as well in a moment. Kosovo and Serbia, the big landmark was certainly the agreement of April 2013, and this was 3 years ago now. Quite a lot of time has passed since, and I think this is the background to what we want to discuss. At the same time, the situation in Europe in that region has, of course, changed very radically. If we take a look at what happened last week in respect of the relations to Turkey, questions of liberalization of visa policies, which we will also look into, then questions of EU enlargement and consolidation policy. And very recently, all this has taken place against the background of a changing security situation in Europe and a changing security discussion in Europe. At the same time, life is continuing in Kosovo. Last year, in spring, in winter even of last year, we were sitting here in Berlin and talked about the refugee crisis starting in Kosovo. We were talking about totally different dimensions and different reasons for people to go to Germany and Western Europe. And here, a few things also have to be put in a somewhat different perspective today. I would like to begin with Spend Ahmeti to begin with a short statement. And I have asked him to provide us with some reasons. I mean, he's not just the mayor of Pristina, that is the mayor of the largest city of Kosovo, but he's also a member of a party, Vete Vendosi. And I would like to ask him, why is it that you take responsibility at a municipal level? And what are your prospects as a large opposition party in taking on political responsibility for the Republic of Kosovo and make a contribution to normalization?
Well, thank you very much. I first would like to thank you, Heinrich Böll Foundation, the Stiftung, for inviting a delegation of the municipality of Pristina to visit Berlin and use this opportunity not just to talk about the city, the capital, but also to talk about this obviously ongoing interest in the topic of the Serbia-Kosovo dialogue. You said at the beginning, can you give us a short statement? It's very difficult to give short statements on the Balkans because it always seems that the situation is complicated to the level that we are always, despite the big problems in Syria, Ukraine, and everything that's going on around security and the Brussels and the terrorist attacks in the past weeks, where again Balkans time and time again becomes a topic of discussion and of interest because of, I would say, still unresolved issues between the countries, between the nations, between the people in the Balkans. I say unresolved because we still have the ongoing, continuous, never-ending dialogue between Kosovo and Serbia. And as some European officials tend to tell us when they come to Pristina, you always have to go on dialogue, you always have to talk to each other. Which is okay, we don't say that we don't have to talk to each other, but the problem is always that we have to find solutions to difficult problems, and they are never final solutions, they're always middle or medium solutions until we have another dialogue that starts somewhere else, and again we have to talk about another solution, which again is not the final solution. Vendosi is known as the opposition that is the most vocal against this dialogue. But I have to make it clear into certain levels of what our policy is. Vetvendose in Albanian means self-determination, a movement rather than a party, which was based to have self-determination of the Kosovo people as the goal. So we are the ones who should be deciding about what our country is going to look like, what our country is going to be. So basically, we fight for a republic in its full understanding and full meaning of the word. In other words, the people are the sovereign of the country, so not other people should decide, but we, the Kosovo people, should decide. So that's the concept of self-determination. We started as a small movement, which basically was as a small protest activism movement, which now has grown into 16 members in the parliament, so around 15% of the vote, and in the last local elections we won the capital, Pristina, through myself, so I'm the mayor since 2 years ago. We are not, in principle, against the dialogue. We are against dialogue without principles. So there is a very fine distinction, because people try to portray us as a movement that is against the dialogue at all costs, and we say we are not against the dialogue, but we are against this dialogue without principles. We say without principles because we believe that this dialogue is on unequal terms. Serbia does not treat Kosovo as an equal dialogue partner, hence it does not treat it as a country. It still treats it in its constitution as a part of Serbia. It still treats it in all of its legal documents as a part of Serbia. It has never taken responsibility for what happened in the 90s in Kosovo. And it still continues to say that it will never recognize Kosovo. It will continue to fight it at every international level. But then they say, let's normalize relations. Kosovo and Serbia are two abnormal countries. Serbia abnormal because it has Kosovo in its constitution and more than 130 countries recognize it, and they pretend that it's not like that. Kosovo because it is a sovereign country but not really sovereign, because it had international protectorate, because still in its constitution has limitations that no other country in the world has. So we're trying basically to normalize relations between two abnormal countries. Normalizing relations between two abnormal countries means that we have to accept that they are abnormal. And our position as Vendosi is, let's normalize the two countries, and then normalization of relations is a normal consequence of this normalization. Despite the fact that our prime ministers have appeared in Brussels smiling, saying that there is an agreement, they look like the relations have improved, the situation on the ground is not so. The distrust between the two communities, because I refuse to call them ethnicities, because ethnicity means somehow like a tribe, not a more of a community, has not improved significantly, as the picture would leave us to believe, between the prime ministers. Instead of a dialogue between Kosovo and Serbia to talk about the Kosovo Serbs, we believe more in a dialogue of Albanians and Serbs in Kosovo to talk about the problems and the relations that we might have. This, instead of believing in institutional integration of the Serbs, we believe in socio-economic integration of all communities. Just to explain to you the difference. In our constitution, it says that two ministers of our government have to be Serbs. We've done that for the past 10 years. But has it improved the life of the Serbs? No, it has improved the life of those two ministers, whose houses have grown exponentially. So when it comes to corruption, there are no difference in nationalities and where they come from. So we believe much more in Serbs from Gračanica being able to sell goods in Pristina. We believe much more in Serbs and Albanians working together in a factory or in a production factory. We believe much more in Serb and Albanian students going to universities together, where not overnight, but in 10 years, it doesn't matter. It won't matter whether your name is Špend or Slobodan. It will matter whether you have a good education system, whether you have a good economy, whether you have a pension, whether you have a good health system. And these are the important issues that matter. We believe that the dialogue is producing quick fixes to ensure stability, to pretend that everything is okay, but it is not solving the main problem, which is the functionality of the country of Kosovo. And I will end with this sentence. We only want to be a normal country. So we want to be compared to Slovenia and be told, you're a normal country, but you're minus 10. You have these problems in corruption, in economic development, in this, in that. But we don't want to be compared to Palestine and be told that we are plus 2. So we want to be treated in the normal country's drawer, where you say, this is a country. These are the problems that you face. This is the problem that you have with minorities. This is how you have to improve human rights. This is how you have to fight corruption. And leave us to work for the next 10, 15 years to overcome these difficulties, to create a normal society that functions and where not everybody is looking for visa liberalization and a way to get out of the country and move to another country where they seek a better life for themselves.
Thank you, Spend. I think there's a lot of material for our further discussion in your statement. Let me turn to this notion of normality, Tatiana. And we discussed it before. And exactly, and to your life. And the agreement, I mean, the agreement is there, and let's orient our discussion first on this agreement and then look further where we go. But if you were to divorce, I don't wish you divorce your husband, but if you were to divorce your husband, to which court would you go? How has this been implemented? There was a lot of saying about court system, rule of law, all kinds of, you know, public services should be normalized for Kosovo's north and the people living there. But now a practical case. If you decided coming back from Berlin, I'm no longer spend my time with your husband and I want to divorce, where would you file your case?
I cannot even imagine such a question, because in order to divorce, I need to do a first horror story, which is to get married. So I cannot even imagine that. And which is a great thing, you know.
And where would you file your marriage papers?
Okay, so at this moment, those people that are fortunate enough to get divorced, or unfortunately, whatever, in the north of Kosovo, they have to file a case to Kraljevo. Kraljevo is a city close to Kosovo. It's one of the southern cities in Serbia, since the court does not function. But I'm afraid if I answer this way, then you can immediately get on a wrong track. So let me just May I add a few points? I would like to answer first to Mr. Akhmeti's until my thoughts have not run away to what he said, and then I'll get back to this kind of normality. So speaking of normality, which I heard this evening for two times, Mr. Akhmeti spoke in a very principled way that he, you know, we want to have a normal country. And speaking again of a normality, I would like to ask you and him in the first place, as we are meeting for the very first time, how would you resolve? It's too strong word, first of all, abnormality. But to use your word, when you say that we are living in two abnormal countries, and since both you and me come from Kosovo, what do you think, how would you resolve this kind of abnormality that today, when I come to you, I'm coming from a Kosovo with the following picture. For 7 months, Kosovo's parliament has been completely dysfunctional, with protests in the first place led by Vetvin Dosje. Mr. Rahmeti comes from this opposition party. Vetvin Dosje is the leader in this kind of protest. This kind of protest 7 months ago, they've started as a huge, massive response to, I agree, politically very inexperienced and clumsy statement by the former head of Srpska Lista at the time when Serbs actually were starting participating in integral part of Kosovo society. He reacted in a very clumsy way after a group of Serbian religious and returnees from Djakovica tried to enter the church on Christmas, and they were banned by a group of Albanians from the same cities, and he publicly said that the savages prevented churchgoers to go to church that day. So we faced originally, like one year ago, we faced this kind of huge protest all around Kosovo. And then these protests continued against the Kosovan government, principally against two Brussels agreements during the normalization process, at the time when actually the EU, Belgrade and Pristina are putting lots of efforts to normalize the situation. So when I'm saying dysfunctional parliament, this is not only part of abnormality currently in Kosovo. There are so many other abnormalities, and I just would like to recall a couple of them, and that's why I'm asking answer, because the Vetvin Dosje is leading this kind of set of abnormalities currently taking place in Kosovo. We have how the parliament has been dysfunctional by using literally the violence in the parliament building. That means set of Molotov cocktails, other firebombs, tear gas, everything happens in front of, let's say, American ambassador, Norwegian ambassador, the chief of the EU, who are trying kind of desperately together with the parliament MPs to hold the sessions. All of you could see who follow Kosovo situation this moment. It's quite a normal picture in such abnormal situation to see the gas masks and tear gas in the parliament, in a democratic institutions. Then you see a huge, like a wave of violence spreading all over Kosovo on streets, using also the Molotov cocktails, the car set on fire. And then this kind of abnormality goes further on. Let me remind you of the literal attacks against the high political leadership in Kosovo at this moment, that the private property of Kosovo minister currently are set under the attacks. Their cars are set on fire. The Molotov cocktail has been recently two times thrown at at the premises of Kosovo president, then on the Kosovo court as well. We had two times in a couple of months a series of cars ablaze at the same time throughout Kosovo cities from the Kosovan institutions. Kosovan ministers have been pelted with eggs. So this kind of violence actually has been lasted for 7 months. And I also have a very strong need to underline other part of the abnormality of Kosovo in these days. And the whole time these attacks are being carried out on the few Serb who have decided to return, primarily, speaking of the south of Kosovo, primarily they are elderly citizens. And this kind of attacks against them has been, in a way, not that very much in the focus of public through due to this major violence at this moment. But when we talk about the attacks against them, there are a wide range of attacks against them, from the thefts in the churches, defacing tombstones, setting fire, to robbing the homes of the returnees. And the only difference between the previous years and these years is that the police has been very discreet about these attacks, not putting the accent on ethnically motivated crimes, but let's say registering them as ordinary crimes. So my really honest question is really, in what way Vet Vendosje, as the key responsible and the strongest opposition group that at this moment is setting the trend of this kind of abnormality in Kosovo, is going to dissolve this kind of abnormal, you know, very violent series of events, and to help minorities, to help other groups, primarily the Kosovo Serbs, to show them the way how we can feel safe if, let's say, the essential democratic institution at this moment, at least for 1 year, they're also very much endangered. And later on, I would be very thankful if I could have the opportunity to explain the perspective of the Northern Serbs, how we fit into this kind of normalization process. In particular, as primarily thanks to Belgrade, for the past 3 years, we are now in the anniversary of 3 years of Brussels Agreement. I would like to put some arguments in what way Belgrade is playing the constructive role by trying to integrate the North into the rest of Kosovan system. So it's completely the opposite way what we've been seeing for the past months and for the past 1 year in Kosovo. Completely the other situation is taking place when it comes to Northern Serbs, not by our will, I have to be frank enough, but at this moment we are really like the North of Kosovo is major argument to show the constructiveness of Belgrade playing in the normalization process, as they in a way forcibly integrated us into the rest of Kosovan citizens. I would be thankful to explain that later.
All right, Tanjana. So do you agree with Spend on this is not really normal? So there is actually some basis for a discussion here. Bodo, I mean, the European Union, I think the last couple of years, a lot of discussions about the European Union and its role in the Western Balkans. And I want to put Bodo a bit in a counterintuitive situation. First of all, what is normal in the European Union? We have a member state called Cyprus. Cyprus is a member state that has a UN mission, where actually, by the way, citizens of Bosnia and Herzegovina are guarding the border line or the green line in Nicosia. So I think the European Union seems to be able to devise a lot of new normalities. And with regard to Kosovo, is there anything that the European Union and its people, Ms. Mogherini, Ms. Ashton, other exponents, member states, have done right in the last couple of years?
Thank you, Tobias. Guten Abend, zum nächsten Mal.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As our guests from Kosovo speak English, I hope they will bear with me for also speaking English now.
To English, so you don't need to put these earphones on. Right or wrong, as I'm coming from a think tank, a kind of foreign policy watchdog organization, so we tend to be perceived as critical towards what the EU is doing. But actually, we're not critical. We're trying to push the EU to be more proactive and more constructive. This has been pretty hard in the last half decade or so since we had the beginning of the euro crisis and a period where we had very little focus on the joint EU foreign and security policy and also on the enlargement policy. So we had a pretty hard time then briefly shifted, I would say, attention to foreign policy with the Ukraine crisis that did obviously not last very long. Now we're deeply into the refugee crisis, which actually overshadows everything, including the policy in the Balkans. So that's just as an introduction. Let me give a second introductory remark. as Spend from Veteran Dossiers here, always, you know, presenting the very fundamentalist, principled policy approach, you know, in a way that that Veteran Dossier has, and I'm not going to judge on Veteran Dossier. We may have a discussion later on that. There are two basic fundamental problems with solving the Kosovo-Serbia issue for the international community, for the US and the European Union, that make it very hard, and here I would speak in favor of the EU and the US, to get to a solution which is very fundamentalist principled. Two principled problems. One, we would not be sitting here had we succeeded to get the Ahtisaari plan through the UN Security Council, through the standard international legal framework. However, Serbia and Russia and China prevented this, which means we are now somehow in a framework where, as Spend said, in a way, we have two unnormal states. Kosovo has gained some kind of independence and sovereignty, but it doesn't have control over its whole territory, especially not over the north, where Tanja is coming from. And Serbia formally has independence and sovereignty, but it includes part of the territory which is not part of its territory anymore, which is Kosovo. The second part is always forgotten, you know, when the whole dialogue is mentioned. And it's in a way overshadowed and not mentioned in the dialogue in a way by the EU too. But this is, there are two unfinished states, not only one. You tend to forget that because in this dialogue always Serbia in a way is on the stronger end because it's the troublemaker, and the troublemaker always more on the forefront and the advantage with the EU and the US. So that's a natural thing, but that's just how it is. So this is one problem. And a second problem here is, which again makes it difficult to have a very principled, very fundamentalist approach, is the EU is divided from the very introducing Kosovo independence through the back door. There are five non-recognizers, and that is a problem. So in a way, we had since independence in 2008 a kind of fake process that led directly into and out of this a frozen conflict in the north that led into the 2011 violence that changed the course. We had 3 years of the EU pretending that there is some policy and some progress. There was a fake kind of EU integration with Serbia. It's a mutual self-deception process. The Serbia, the previous democratic forces-led government of President Tadic, was pretending they could get both EU membership and Kosovo, knowing like the whole Serbian political elite since 2008 that Kosovo is gone. Of course, nobody will say it aloud, but they knew it since 2008. On the other side, the EU was pretending, you know, our partner is a democratic partner. He knows that Kosovo is gone. We won't push him too hard. We will continue the integration process, and, you know, reason will prevail at some point, and they will back down on Kosovo. Of course, we know that this couldn't function in the Balkans. It didn't function, and it led to a frozen conflict status in the north of Kosovo, which is never a frozen conflict, is a wrong term. These are very dynamic frozen conflicts. It led to the violence we saw. And it led to something very unique during the EU crisis, and that was progress in my understanding. Germany, the German chancellor, taking leadership within the EU. We did not see any German foreign policy leadership throughout the EU crisis anywhere except for Kosovo. For one very profane reason, because these Serb people with arms, they were shooting on Serbian German KFOR soldiers. So that is was a very simple explanation, but that led to German leadership, and that led into the dialogue, and in a way led to the end of the cooperation and alliance with the so-called democratic forces in Serbia, and it led us into the dialogue and the April agreement in a very, very strange setting. It's a setting with the former ruling forces of the 90s in Serbia, former Serbian Radical Party, now the SNS, and the Socialist Party. Shifting course, a German chancellor going to Belgrade in August 2011, with which she shifted policy, saying, okay, we're on the stronger end, you want Serbia, you want to enter the European Union, you try to play for 3 years to divide you with the 5 non-recognizers, that won't help you. First, in order to get into the U, you don't need the 5 non-recognizers, you need the rest of the recognizers. And second, the time of border change is over, basically saying, you know, Kosovo is gone, and you need to accept that reality in order to get into the European Union. So that shifted course, and I think that was a major thing concerning all the you know, inadequacies and all the problems the EU is having as a joint actor, including, you know, as a divided actor. Mm-hmm. And that got us the April agreement. And if you give me 2 more minutes, that was a very, you know, on the one side, it was only the first agreement on full normalization. We tend to forget that in a meanwhile. So only the first agreement. And it had a very ambitious implementation deadline, 6 months up until 2013. Everybody knew this is not realistic, but it was necessary to do. However, we are now in the 3rd year of delay of implementation of this. This is already serious. And even more serious, we have both a crisis, an internal deep political crisis based on the question of the lack of democracy in Kosovo. It started in 2014. Had some intervention by the West, especially Germany, we can discuss this later. Short-sighted intervention which did not create stability and progress for a long time. It created some progress and a deep-blocking situation for half a year, but here we are back in the crisis after 8-9 months, and it's deeper than ever, probably since the independence of Kosovo. On the other side, it's also a crisis of the dialogue. The opposition, which is blocking the institutions with our institutional means that Tatiana just laid out what they are, probably violent, though I think concerning the violent potential in Kosovo, this is very dosed violence still. It could get much, much worse. With a stating that a second agreement, that was the only progress, if we may say so, since beginning of 2014, except for a minor progress at integration of judiciary in the north, it was already there in 2014, but formalized beginning of 2015, is the August 25th agreement last year on the formation of the Association of Serbian Municipalities. That's the reason, at least the stated reason, for the opposition to protest, block the institutions, and that's the whole question of, and the question of loss of trust of the EU's policy in Kosovo, and part of the opposition and part of the citizens, whether this whole agreement and the whole dialogue policy is leading to the reintegration or integration of the north, the Serb majority north of Kosovo into Kosovo, and finally at an end point to full sovereignty. That's what the EU is stating, with some collective protective ethnic mechanisms and rights. And some linking of them with local self-governments, or whether this is leading to, and Spend already mentioned it, a total dysfunctionality like we have it in Bosnia, a kind of Republika Srpska we have in Bosnia, a kind of third layer of government, a middle layer of regional autonomy of Serbs that will lead to a complete dysfunctionality of the Kosovo state. And last one sentence, we have very worrying recent polls from Kosovo saying that 70% of Kosovars are, I don't recall it, either against the agreement or against the dialogue. So this is a total watershed in comparison to what we had so far.
Okay. Thank you, Bodo, for not disappointing. It was really difficult for you to find something that the EU have done right. And you even managed not to mention that there is a European Parliament that has tried to be a bit of a different voice than maybe the European External Action Service and the member states. But Ulrike, if I may, I mean, it's about normalization of Kosovo-Serbia relations, and we have invested as a European taxpayer quite a lot of money in this so far. Why should actually we continue investing this a very abnormal state of affairs, while obviously, you know, we need to also invest in democracy at home? And the problem of very entrenched kind of difficulties with, as Bodo has pointed out, seem, you know, not very prone to European intervention and mediation so far. So where is the light on the end of the tunnel in terms of European engagement in this process?
All right, so it's a bit difficult for me not to, where to start, because in general, most of the what has been said here at the panel, most of these things I share also in analysis and many of those things. And I'm saying that because I've been rapporteur for Kosovo in the European Parliament since 2009, since when I joined the European Parliament, and have been following the country very closely since then. Rapporteur, just to explain, means that all the six Western Balkan states plus Turkey, the seven countries that are in the process of enlargement, all those have one member of the European Parliament from the Foreign Affairs Committee assigned to one of those countries for all the 5 years, and follow up each year in the fall after the European Commission gives its progress report on the country with a report, a resolution in the European Parliament on that. So that's the formal position of what I'm doing as rapporteur for Kosovo in the Parliament. And as such, and you know, the European Parliament is the one that decides by majorities and not by unanimity like in the Council. So for us, it's easier to take decisions, and the European Parliament has been the one that since the beginning, since 2008, has been behind, with a good majority, behind the independence of Kosovo and recognized Kosovo as such, even though the Parliament doesn't have any binding opinion on that. But we always talked about Kosovo as a republic, as an independent country, etc., etc. So with that background, I'd like to go back to the question you did before, because what is normal in the EU? Because for me, one of the big problems when I look at what the European Union has been doing is that we have one big abnormality when we look at the European Union as such, and when referring to Kosovo, it really becomes very obvious there. We have a parliament that does not have legislative power by itself, but more than that, we have the Council, which is the governments of member states that are executive in their own home countries, that have to do what their parliaments say, but they are legislative at the European level, meaning that is a democratic incompatibility. Because, of course, they don't want to decide anything at European level that makes them problems at home. And, I mean, they're the ones who have that power, and that, for Kosovo, for me, is one of the basic reasons why, as European Union, we haven't been moving forward, also in order to stabilize now in a positive sense, and not in the one where keep everything quiet and nothing moves, yeah? But in a positive sense, Kosovo and also the relations between Kosovo and Serbia. Because if also the Council would decide by majority, we would have 23 member states recognizing Kosovo, and the other five simply would have to accept and not make problems time and again in a very tedious procedure. Let me just give you one example, apart from the dialogue, where the five really haven't been that much of a problem. But with the stabilization and association agreement that we finally have with Kosovo, the first step towards enlargement, towards integration of Kosovo in the EU, it took, I think, over a year to get Spain, which is one of the five non-recognizers, to accept the stabilization and association agreement. Yeah. Because, and that was just one of the stories, they didn't want to talk about a nation, a country, a state, because they were afraid the Catalans then would use that. I've been trying over those 6 years now to talk with representatives, ministers, even heads of states or governments of all the five, trying to convince them that if they recognized Kosovo, it wouldn't give their national minorities any sort of any real reason in order to use Kosovo in order to argue for independence. Because none of the democratic governments of those five member states of the EU, Spain, Cyprus, Greece, Romania, and Slovakia, have done to their ethnic minorities ever what Milosevic did to the Kosovo Albanians, period. Well, we still are at that. So that's when we talk about normal relations. Now, on the dialogue, maybe adding up to what Bodo Weber just said, yes, Angela Merkel played an important role there, but the dialogue didn't start because of that. It started after Serb then Minister of Foreign Affairs, Jeremic, and the Serb government went to the International Court of Justice to go against the declaration of independence of Kosovo. The court didn't agree on that position, but nevertheless, the Serbs took it to the UN again. And in 2010, I think it was at that time Ashton's success to not have it again at the UN level, because that would have been very detrimental to the then very young Republic of Kosovo. So that's where the dialogue was a kind of way out of again having major problems for Kosovo at the UN level. So in that sense, I have always been defending the principle of having that dialogue. The problems that I've had with it was, for example, when it started from the beginning, Robert Cooper, who then was the major negotiator under Ashton, and I talked to him a couple of times, I tried to tell them, please, and to Ashton as well, you also need to talk to Kosovo Parliament and Serb Parliament and to Kosovo citizens and the Serb citizens. Don't just leave it to the two prime ministers or other ministers, because they, when they then talk at home, they will use their words and will explain what they, how they interpret the agreement, but not what was really agreed upon. Until now, with Mogherini, I have a bit more hope that there will be a bit more of openness towards the societies in both countries. But that was, for me, one of the big problems there. And yes, it's true that this kind of treating both countries in that way, Serbia, a country that still has Kosovo in its constitution. I always tell also the Serbs, and I try to have good relations also with the Serb government and parliament. I go there and part of the delegation of the European Parliament with Serbia, because I'm very much in favor of seeing all the six Western Balkan countries progressing, also Serbia. And that's why, getting back to your first question, why I think it's important with the EU having invested so much. Look, for me, investing money and efforts is an important part of democratic procedures. Yeah? And for me, all the Western Balkans are part of Europe, geographically, but also historically, and I want to see all of them in the EU. Well, my position, unfortunately, doesn't have a big majority, also not among citizens in the EU. And that's where I come to one of the criticisms I also have very much of Vete Vendosje, and I've been discussing with you and with many others many times on that. Sometimes I have the feeling that the problems that, or the other way around. Those of you who live here in Berlin, I guess most of you do so, what is what you see on TV here in Germany about Kosovo? I'm afraid the only thing you see, the few times Kosovo is ever mentioned, is not good progress in some issues, some progress on lots of issues that exist, but it's tear gas in the assembly. And that for me as a parliamentarian, I've been an Austrian parliamentarian 10 years before I joined the European Parliament, and from the Greens, so I don't always agree with everything a government does. but for me, that is something I cannot accept as a method of political demonstration. Because if you're elected as a parliamentarian, you should use all kinds of measures inside the parliament. But using violence, that simply creates an image of your country, apart from what it does maybe to people that are in the assembly, that hurts so much to what I want to see how Kosovo is seen in the EU. And there has been lots of progress over the last years. Yeah, you've had until now a president, even though some of you don't like her either. I think Atifete Yayaga has been doing a great job, especially to the outside, to convey a modern European, not just image, but also reality of what Kosovo could be seen like, yeah, and could be viewed. And when we talk about visa liberalization, something essential for Kosovars. The Kosovars are the only citizens of the Western Balkans, of all the six countries, that are not allowed to travel freely here. I don't know how much problems you had to get your visa to come here. I find this outrageous, yeah? And I'm trying to lobby the whole commission to really move ahead, yeah? Because it's simply something I cannot accept. But how will you get ministers of the interior who'll have to decide. And I think with unanimity, in the situation we have now with terrorism, just yesterday in Brussels, and with refugees, how will you convince them? How do you want to convince them that yes, Kosovars should travel freely? If it's only, I mean, it's 1.5 million or something Kosovars, yeah? But how do you want to convince them? This is tough. I try that as well. But that for me really is something I cannot accept. And I want Kosovo to be a normal country and Serbia to be a normal country. And I'm finalized now for the first part with one thing. I just recently had a long interview with the Serbian Courier, the magazine they do in English sometimes. And I was quite astonished. And I'm quite frank in what I am answering questions. So they put at the title of that, I was asked the question, well, should Serbia recognize Kosovo? And I said, yes, of course. And my main argument there is no way out, because even the non-recognizers will not allow Serbia into the EU, not just because of Serbia, but because of Cyprus. We'll never again have a country join the European Union that does not have clear borders. The Serbs like it or not, that's a fact. Yeah? So simply it's there, and I have to say, I think some in the Serb government know that. And I hope, before the elections or afterwards in Serbia now, they will also be very clear about that. And in that way, it's important also, of course, and but we'll be, I'll stop now to come to the north of Kosovo and Serbs and Kosovo Albanians, etc. But I think that's very clear, and I think everybody knows it, but more should talk about it and say it also in Serbia.
Thank you, Ulrike. Spend, of course, there were a number of issues raised to which you would like to respond. Maybe there are just some leftovers for myself when you were talking, actually. It reminded me extremely about the discourse of the United Kingdom Independence Party or the PIS party in Poland. So where you basically say we want, you know, nationalist agenda, full independence, respect for what we want, etc. And it really sounds to me a bit bizarre that we now back in 2016 and here we talk about a very nationalist discourse. And forgive me if I say even what you said sounded extremely nationalist. I had the pleasure or not to listen to Beata Szydło, the Prime Minister of Poland, and I think you could have interchanged your speaking notes of, you know, the kind of agendas. So what would you actually bring into a normal Kosovo, into a European Union with such a nationalist agenda?
First of all, I will ask for a few more minutes because I think a lot of issues
you
were raised.
You get as much as the others.
we have nothing in common with UKIP. And it's absolutely, I refuse, and I would say, because it's a friendly panel, I feel offended being compared to UKIP because we are not a right-wing nationalist party. We are a social democratic movement that is fighting for sovereignty of its country. I have absolutely no problem in living with any other nationality in my country as long as we're equal. But I'm not ashamed of the fact that I'm Albanian. And I don't say I'm Albanian because my blood is Albanian, because that's not the type of concept of a nation that we have. Our concept is of a modern nation. I say, Ms. Lunacek, if she wants tomorrow, she can become Albanian, she can become a citizen of Kosovo. No, because we believe in the modern concept of nation. As I believe that if I wanted and I accepted everything that Germany has to offer me, I would, you know, sometimes even I feel I could declare myself I'm German. So I believe in that concept of a nation. So we have nothing, not even with Polish party. I absolutely, you know, I would say we have in common with social democratic, because we are a center-left movement fighting for equality. I will first respond to Madam Lunacek. Of course, we speak very often. I agree with her on many of the analyses that we do together, and she does, and I read her reports, and in the analysis part, it's an objective analysis of the situation. And I congratulate the European Parliament in passing so many resolutions that reflect on what is going on in Kosovo. Where I disagree is this question of image. Because for me, image is a portrayal of the inner functionality of a country. So if I'm poor, I can put on the best clothes, but I'm still poor. So I can appear, and we can have Atifete Yahyaoga, who I respect. She looks good when she goes, a woman president of Kosovo. But how much political power does she have in Kosovo? How much was she able to resolve issues as president? So when our prime minister comes to Germany to meet Merkel, I'm not interested whether Germany put a red carpet. I'm interested in what they spoke in the meeting. So the question of image, to me, does not matter if the country is not functioning and we have poverty and we have corruption and we have all these issues. If I'm a minister of internal affairs in Europe, I will not accept visa liberalization for Kosovo because of 30,000 people who left Kosovo in 2015, not because of the tear gas in parliament. And those 30,000 people leaving Kosovo, they're not leaving because of the tear gas in parliament. They left in January, February of 2015. There was no tear gas in parliament. There were no protests. These people left because they had no economic opportunity. And after spending 3 billion euros of European money in Kosovo since 1999, which is the biggest amount of any country in terms, in per capita terms, this is a question that EU should be asking itself. Why did we spend 1 billion euros on EULEX? What are the results that EULEX has brought? Are there criminals who are in jail because of EULEX? How many corruption cases were tried? 2 billion euros in assistance. How much economic development has that brought? These are the questions that we should be asking. Tear gas is an effect of different causes. Now, it's not about even defending it, but you cannot compare the Austrian parliament or the European parliament with the Kosovo parliament. No, because, exactly. I want to be like the Austrian parliament. But you know what's the difference? And let me just tell you, because then I will come back to Tatiana and what she was saying. The agreement in Brussels says one of the things. I cannot be a commander of the police in the north just because I was born Albanian. Just because I was born Albanian. It says only a Serb can be a commander of the police in the north. Unacceptable for me. Unacceptable. I don't believe in this. I will never say a Serb cannot be a commander of the police in Pristina just because they were born Serb. Because I don't think that born into a certain nationality makes you a good police officer or not. I cannot go to court with a Serb in the appellate court in front of an Albanian judge just because I was born Albanian and just because the other side was born Serb. This is racist. This is anti-European. This is unacceptable for me as a human being. So when these issues come to Parliament and they tell us, accept these, I would love to use the normal parliamentary. I'm not a member of Parliament, by the way. But it would be good if we use the normal parliamentary functions, but this is not a normal parliament. It's not a normal country. It's not a normal situation, not a normal agreement. And I said, in Bosnia, Europe again sponsored a Dayton agreement that it cannot get out of. It has, you know, Carl Bildt says now Bosnia cannot join the EU because it's not too sovereign, it's not enough sovereign. And he was one of the persons who backed up the Dayton agreement, even, you know, when it was drafted. We just want normality for our country, and we would love to be a normal parliament like the Austrian parliament and not to have to use, absolutely not to have to use tear gas. When I listened to Tatiana, she spoke more about the Kosovo government than about the Kosovo Serbs. And I would like to hear more the position of the Kosovo Serbs, because I heard more defending the Kosovo government, which I really don't understand. Vedvendosi did not throw Molotov cocktails. Vedvendosi is not torching government cars. Never. 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 I would never accept that. I am a strictly non-violent person. I don't believe in violence. I believe in non-violent means to achieving goals. And this is what we've done. Second, what you have to understand is that you've been hearing about the Advent Dossier from the wrong people. I suggest that you meet with Advent Dossier. I suggest that you ask Advent Dossier, what is the position? I suggest you talk to the Pristina Serbs. Ask them, how do they feel in Brnica? I suggest that we go together. More than 150 houses, we go together, we talk to them, because I go there every couple of weeks. We talk to them, ask them how they feel in Pristina. Are they threatened? Or are they, are their problems solved? Do they feel, let me just finish. Do they feel equal? Which is what I want, which is what I, what we want to achieve, equality. You see, the problem, Tatiana, is that I, for the last 15 years, I see billboards in Kosovo, K4, which says tolerance. I don't agree with that. Which means that I hate the Serbs, but I have to tolerate them. It's not the truth. I don't accept that. I don't need to tolerate you. I need to accept you as an equal citizen. And you need to accept me as an equal citizen. And this is what we want, equality. Come and talk to us. Let's talk about this country. Let's talk about how your life can be better. Let's talk about how my life can be better. About your job, about your pension, about your health system. Because, you know, I know Serbian history better than I know Kosovo's history. I really do. You know, the situation has forced us to do so. And if you allow me, I would say Vucic is not good for Serbia. I really, you know, I really have good intentions for Serbia, because I believe that if my neighbor is good, I will be good. Vucic is not good for Serbia. The guy has become a better politician. It is true, because he understands the situation better. But has the situation in Serbia really changed? When you say constructive, what do you mean constructive? You see what Serbia has done in UNESCO? Calling us ISIS, spending millions of euros trying to not to allow us to become, which I think would be better for the churches in Kosovo. Because they would be put under protection by the UN. We would have to report better. When a dance team from Kosovo tried to participate in Eurovision, Serbia sends a letter of protest. Eurovision, dance contest.
Song contest.
No, it was a dance team that wanted to participate. That is not a constructive approach. Let alone football, basketball, not allowing us in sports. The question that comes, because we know, we've seen Vucic before. The only time in history when Vucic, Dacic and Nikolic were together was 99, during the Kosovo War. It's the only time. Vucic in 97 said in parliament, for every Serb you kill, we will kill 100 Muslims. Now he says you put that out of context. I would ask Vucic, what kind of context it is okay to say we will kill 100 Muslims? They need to take responsibility for this. If they want to improve relations with the Albanians, with us, if you want us to trust the Kosovo, the Serb government, they have to show that they really mean it by taking responsibility for what has happened in the 90s. That's how you improve on reconciliation. We take full responsibility.
Should less than 5% of population take
absolutely not, but you are bringing Serbia.
I don't, 95% of Kosovo. Who is taking the responsibility?
If you ask me, I would keep Belgrade out of this.
No, let's talk about that.
I don't find you responsible
for what
has happened.
I'm asking about me as a Kosovo Serb. At this moment, I'm less than 5% of the population in Kosovo. Yes. Should I take the responsibility to improve the relation with you, or we really have to count who is coming first to whom?
No, I will come to you. No problem.
Have you come?
Yes, of course, all the time.
In what way?
All the time, in every way.
Can I ask you a question? Speaking of
I am from Mitrovica, by the way.
Yeah, so. I can see that. You know, we are very emotional, both of me. You can immediately recognize. Which flags do you wear at the protest? Do you wear Kosovo flag or Albanian flag? When we see the protest of Advent Dossier, what kind of flags do we see?
What does it matter?
No, can I just get the answer? I'm just asking, curious.
I have the Kosovo flag in my office.
But
I have
on the streets, what kind of flags do you wear?
I said at the beginning, I'm not ashamed that I'm Albanian.
I'm just asking why.
Yes. Are you offended by the Albanian flag?
No, I'm asking why.
It's the question that we have.
No, I'm asking,
who's offended by the Albanian flag? I'm not offended by the Serbian flag, despite what has happened in life. You see, I have no problem.
Because of Eurovision contest. What was the problem about the flag with the Eurovision contest? If you don't, I'm just out of curiosity, really asking. Why are you ashamed to wear Kosovo flags during your protest at Advent Dossier?
No, I'm not ashamed.
Why there are no Kosovo flags on streets during the protests?
Yes,
there are only Albanian UÇK flags.
No.
Take the pictures, please. Have the pictures and see the pictures.
Yes, we can show the pictures, but that's not the case.
One in ten. See the massive. What Vatan Dosi is showing.
Yeah, please finish your intervention, and then it was Tatiana.
I'm saying to Tatiana,
if you ask me, I would keep Belgrade out of this, but the Kosovo.
Me too. I would be the happiest person if Belgrade would be at this moment out of.
We have an agreement.
Yes.
We don't need the European Union. Let's start a dialogue between.
I need European Union, but I don't need Belgrade.
No. We go.
Okay.
We sit. We discuss. I just want to be equal with you. I just want to have the same opportunities as you do. I want you to have the same opportunities as I have. But today that's not the case. And I told the Serbs, even in Pristina. In Pristina, you will not be discriminated, but you will not be privileged. I consider you as an equal citizen of this city. You have problems with sewage, they will be solved. And I don't care if your name is Serb or Albanian. I really don't. Even if you know, wear the Serbian flag, I have no problem. I respect your nationality. I respect what you, where you come
check,
from.
You should check Absolutely. The post of Vatvin Dosi. Sorry, but
I am Vatvin Dosi. We should
Sven
check.
Finish Sorry. This intervention. Sven, are you finished? Okay, I think we get a bit of the gist of. No, I mean. I didn't want to disturb the dialogue between the two of you, because both of you said you did want have a dialogue. So, Tatiana, I think there were a number of issues you wanted to react to.
I can't answer all of them.
No, you don't need to answer then. But he said something, Sven said something very important. He wants to have the same opportunities as you have. I think this relates a bit to maybe the double identity of people in northern Kosovo, in terms of their probably also double citizenship. And how this impacts actually the process which we're discussing here, normalization. Do you feel that you're more privileged than Spend is in certain degrees?
I would, at this moment, I am generously giving all of my privileges in Kosovo to you if we can switch our places. But I'm afraid if we start this way, then we will be having cycling of history, you know, like every 50 years, this kind of mantra. One people is privileged over the other people. And I think we are not on fair grounds to discuss this way. Yeah, okay. So, but when you were asking about privileges, you've touched the consequence. And I'm afraid, you know, there is one proverb in Latin saying blind as a fact. So I'm just thinking then when Mr. Ahmeti mentioned why this kind of privileges to Serbs, I want them to be equal citizens. I would ask the question, have you ever asked yourself where does this positive discrimination come from? In the most places, why does it come from? Why the democratic EU has decided all of a sudden to incorporate into the Brussels Agreement anything that is connected to positive discrimination? Have you ever thought why really someone says, okay, in the north, let's have a Serbian police commander? First of all, the Brussels Agreement, to my knowledge, doesn't mention that, but there is mutual understanding between the three parties, the Serb, the Pristina, Belgrade, and the EU, that naturally, during the process of integration of the North into the rest of Kosovan system, it's completely natural and acceptable to have the Serbian police commander. So there are like two ways how we can answer. If you really see the history of the integration of Kosovo Serbs into the rest of Kosovo system, from the UNMIK times, from the first institution, you could see the principle of the positive discrimination. I myself am not happy that I am not strong enough that I can really compete with the majority of community on fair ground. But then you should really ask yourself, as a majority, from where does this positive discrimination come from? What happened that less than 5% of one population has been positively discriminated, to have guaranteed seats in the parliament, to have like a mutual understanding why the Serbs has to be commander, etc. It's because really at this moment the Serbian population is less than 5% in the project that the EU project allowed Kosovo to be a state only not as a mono-ethnic state, but as a multinational, multi-ethnic state. And you have to all of a sudden, as a majority, show that there is really like a true multi-ethnic state. And then you have the problem with the less of 5% of one population at this moment, why they are privileged in something? I first of all wouldn't call that privilege because I'm in a way handicapped. If someone has to give me, you know, an assistance, that is not my privilege. That's just reminding me how, you know, in what kind of discrimination I could end up. That's A. And B, can you imagine this kind of multi-ethnic state when less than 5% of one population in this moment, so the figures already tell you that 5% of one population cannot endanger 95% of the rest of the population. So at this very moment, this 5% of one population has been already endangered. And you could clearly see that anywhere else in the south. And what is really more, why, when I mentioned why Belgrade is constructive, first of all, personally, I'm one of the biggest criticizers of anything at the moment that comes from Belgrade. So let's be very clear, I'm, you know, completely contrary of support to the regime. I'm personally feeling very humiliated as a native of Mitrovica, as a native of Kosovo Serbs, that I had to deal, you know, with the majority of Kosovo Albanians with the assistance from Belgrade. You know, I myself would like to have more self-rule. And I, in the first place, I think that the great insult that has been done to Kosovo Serbs, especially the Northern Serbs, that we were not part of the negotiating table at the Brussels Agreement. At the same time, when all three sides together, Pristina, Belgrade, and the EU, are telling me that the most of the agreements, like a series, the package of the agreement, are to resolve the betterness of my daily life through a series of agreement. So that's already unnatural and that's already problematic part of the Brussels Agreement. And here I can agree to you, but I think it affects, big time it affects Northern Serbs, Kosovo Serbs, as we've been completely marginalized from this way. But to show you why the North at this moment really show how Belgrade has played a constructive role, when I describe abnormal situation in Kosovo these days, which really is for 1 year very abnormal, and can you imagine in a mature year of the dialogue, at the moment when there are no threats of Milosevic or, I don't know, Vucic coming with the army, or Kosovo Serbs threatening to Pristina, or, you know, this kind. You don't have this threat of Serbs any longer. So now it looks like the Kosovan state has been destroyed from the inner part of Kosovo. It, you know, like Albanians at this moment are dismantling their own state in a very mature process of the dialogue. That tells me that they are not only against the government, but it really affects the dialogue with the Serbs big time. Because can you imagine, like, we had like 17 years of short history, but very strong history, that the north of Kosovo has very strongly opposed to any kind of integration. At least for two reasons, main reasons. A, we had like Serbian state, at least for 100 years, functioning in Kosovo without any interruption, especially in the north. So our Serbian institution have not been dismantled in 1999. We feel them as a natural part of our population, starting from health houses, post offices, schools, etc., etc. It's not only a political question for us, but it's our everyday, you know, question. A, and we feel very natural when it comes to them. You know, that's the system that we feel safe, the safest, and, you know, most natural. And B, which is even more important, for 17 years. By any argument, you could see a very, very bitter experience of Southern Serbs. When it comes to their feeling, have they been respected? Have they been loved? Have they been wanted? Have they been physically safe by their Albanian neighbors, by the majority? And all of those ethnically motivated crimes, the discrimination, the lack, at least the lack of tolerance, you know, the general feeling of lack of tolerance, including, you know, all physical threat attacks, that happened in the huge presence of international community, both military, police, and administrative. So those are two reasons for the Northern Serbs that they feel, you know, we didn't want to be that, the part of that system. Now, 3 years, in the light of the anniversary of Brussels Agreement, Belgrade has done tremendous job what Belgrade has done in order to integrate the north into Pristina. I am critical to that. I know why Belgrade has done, because of their own acceleration to the EU process. But Belgrade removed overnight the entire political leadership, not only the radical political leadership in the north, but including the most moderate one. I'm just reminding you of Mr. Oliver Ivanovic, seen by most of you know, international community as the most moderate leader, and to remind you that he's currently serving, you know, his sentence in jail over the ethnic crimes. At the moment when many international partners are not persuaded into his guilt. What Belgrade has also done, Belgrade has dismantled officially, through the government, dismantled the Serbian institutions first time after 100 years. They dismantled the municipalities, official municipalities, they were dismantled. What Belgrade has done instead of that, you cannot produce the administrative vacuum. So they, in order psychologically and physically to prepare us for the integration process, for the past 3 years, they have invested a temporary, extraordinary, by the law system, temporary buffer zone through which they made us to participate in something that was unthinkable 3 years ago, like cost of elections, to mention cost of elections in the north to the population. That was like you are mentioning a devil. So Belgrade succeeded to have us in the Kosovan poll. With the support of Belgrade, Kosovo-Serbian mayors were elected. Kosovo-Serbian ministers were elected. People are participating in Kosovo institutions. I personally am so critical of them, but let's see the facts. This is everything what Belgrade has done and went even further on. Belgrade, with the support from Belgrade, the structures in the north, unthinkable, were dismantled, such as courts, civilna zaštita, and, you know, lots of institutions. So at this moment, you cannot say that, you know, from your perspective of view, Belgrade is not playing a constructive role.
All right. I'm sorry. Yeah, no, don't worry. Ulrike asked for the floor.
This is not fair, you're not allowed.
This is not about fairness. This is about moderating a very complicated discussion. You'll get the microphone back. Don't worry, Spend. Ulrike, you asked for the floor to react. I think there was quite some you know, factual stuff going back and forth,
and you've been the master. The floor again,
he will have the floor.
But let me also on some things, and I'll start with the agreement of August 2015. Tatiana, I've got it here, and it definitely says, among other things, the commander of this region, the police regional commander, shall be a Kosovo Serb nominated by the Ministry of Internal Affairs from a list provided by the four mayors on behalf of the community association. So it definitely says it has to be a Kosovo Serb. You said it doesn't say so. It says so. I've got it here. No,
but it's a public document, so I think.
And that, for me, I mean, and I've been talking about that also with Ms. Mogherini and others. I definitely think that that is a problem in the text. Not that most probably the commander would be a Kosovo Serb anyway, but to write it in an agreement that, and that's clear, in the Kosovo Constitution, you are not allowed to say, I mean, to say of which ethnic origin a person should be. Yeah, most probably it would be a Serb anyway. Yeah, so I told him I don't really understand why they put it in there. Was the pressure of Belgrade too much for that? I think in reality, it wouldn't have been a problem to put it without that definition. So for me, that is one thing where I just needed to contradict you, because that simply wasn't true. And I appreciate many of the efforts that Belgrade has done, but Belgrade, and here I also agree with you, I would prefer that would be dealt between Kosovars, Serbs and Albanians, maybe with some help of the EU or whoever, yeah? But when you said that Serbia and Belgrade has now destroyed all the parallel structures and all of that, that's simply not true. Well, you said, and they have done a lot, but I've got here the latest big deal, the copies of what is being done by journalists and researchers from both countries, Serbia and Kosovo, over the last year and a half, every half year, and what has been implemented and what not. And there, I mean, you can read all the details of where progress is not good enough, yeah? But mostly for citizens. And when I just read the news right now with the blocking again of the borders for trucks going, first from Kosovo into Serbia, they are blocked, and now the Kosovars are blocking the Serbs. I mean, these games should really be over, yeah? And I find it there, I also see that there hasn't been too much, and I mostly talk about the EU side now, there hasn't been enough pressure also from the EU side to really get the implementation done. The telephone code for Kosovo, I mean, this is ridiculous. Yeah, there's still, your phone number is still, what is it, Slovenian, Monacan? I mean, this is ridiculous, yeah? And it's expensive as well. And now I hear that, that Serbia is demanding not only, I don't know how many antennas, but double of the antennas in order to be able to say yes to that. I mean, this is really going enough. And yes, I support the dialogue in contradiction to some, but more needs to be done. And in my last report, I also demanded from the EU, Mogherini and the others, that they do a regular reporting to all the parliaments. The Belgrade, the Serbian one, the Kosovo one, and the European Parliament one regularly about what has been achieved and what not, yeah? And do that regularly so also citizens will know how much has been done and how much not. So, and the other thing, again, spend once more on the Parliament thing and on the symbols and the image. Having been a politician now for more than 20 years, I know that in politics, also symbols and images are important, not only the laws and not only what is done. So in that sense, yes, I would defend also the president of the still president of the Fethi Yayaga and others, because it I mean, and I live in this part of Europe, yeah, in the sort of the EU part. I know how important these images are, yeah, and I know how important it was when Ati Fethi Yayaga went to visit and talk to and visit presidents of different countries of the EU, yeah, because it gave an image, and you know that the image of Kosovo, unfortunately, yeah, is still not a very good one, unfortunately. Because of many reasons, yeah, and lots of efforts of some countries not to give Kosovo a good image. Yeah? So that's why it's important. And the last thing, you yourself said that you want non-violent means to achieve goals. There, I really want to ask you whether you think that tear gas is a non-violent way. I mean, you explained why Peter Bendossi is doing it, and I know you're not in the parliament, but I simply, that is something I would wish that Wete Vendosje would see what it also means to the outside, not just to the inside. And that's it. I think it's damaging to the inside as well, but also to the outside, especially in a situation that we have all over Europe now. I think it's harming many things that you also want, and that I don't like.
Now, as I don't want to be blamed of being unfair, you have 1 or 2 minutes to finish your point. Otherwise, I'll give the floor to Bodo, and I ask the public now to quickly, slowly prepare for questions as well. I give you your 1.5 minutes.
Okay, 1.5 minutes.
And then Bodo, and please, sorry, I'm just making the announcement to the public. Someone will walk around with a microphone. The person will not give you the microphone, so you can make comments or questions.
Okay. Since I only have 1.5 minutes, I will respond to Tatiana and then later to Ulrike. I find it very disturbing, Tatiana, that Belgrade can remove overnight the political leadership of Serbs in Kosovo.
Me too.
I, you know, you said you were happy with the constructive approach because they did in one night remove all. That means that the politics of Kosovo Serbs is in Belgrade hands, which I find it very disturbing. I don't think it should be the case. I think the Kosovo Serbs should be speaking with their own voice, not through Belgrade. Because it has shown time and time again that this is not working even for the Kosovo Serbs. It's not working. I meet Kosovo Serb politicians almost on daily basis, and I see how it reflects on what they want to achieve, and everything they have to do, they have to ask Vucic in Belgrade through a phone call. They cannot even vote a single parliament law before asking Vucic on the phone whether it's okay to vote for it or not. Here is the difference between what I think is a constructive and a non-constructive approach. If Serbia had said, Kosovo is a finished issue for us, I know they might be telling secretly to European officials that, you know, but publicly, I've never heard a Serbian official government representative saying that the Kosovo is going to be recognized. Never. And I listen to the public statements. I don't know what they tell them secretly. So, if Serbia had said, Kosovo is finished for us, we will eventually recognize it, but we are worried about the rights of Kosovo Serbs. That is a legitimate dialogue issue. But if Serbia says, we will never recognize Kosovo, Kosovo is ISIS, Dačić. Pristina is like Palmyra, Dačić. These guys are a non-state Islamic fundamentalists who are destroying everything that comes to their hands, and this is a non-functional state that we will never recognize. And on top, we want an association there. What does it tell me as a Kosovo official? It tells me that you want the association as a potential tool to destabilize, defunctionalize the state of Kosovo whenever it seems appropriate for Belgrade. That is unacceptable to me. Okay. As a Kosovo citizen.
Bodo, now, how do we get out in a principled manner out of the total blockade and to some detention? But also try to be a bit short in 2 or 3 minutes, and that we have enough time for the discussion.
I like
the with
also
the public.
Short, yeah. In a principled manner, look again, I would disappoint the panel here to first make a remark on, you were talking about, you know, best way would be that Kosovo Serbs and Kosovo Albanians, you know, have a dialogue without Serbia. While I, on a principled manner, completely agree, I think this is completely unrealistic. For which reason? Listen, the disintegration of Yugoslavia in the 80s started with the manipulation of Kosovo Serbs by Belgrade. We now have a 3-decade history of manipulation of Kosovo Serbs by Belgrade. And we have the whole history that happened throughout that period out of this manipulation. There simply is not a realistic base, you know, to start fixing the Kosovo problem, the problem of sovereignty and the problem with Serbs, with starting with kicking out Belgrade. Already, you know, from the state of mind of Serbs in the north. You may disagree, maybe not. This is one point. The other point is, because of the, while I would love to see a Kosovo state based on a civic nation model, again, I think because of the history of the 90s, 10 years of segregation, of Serbs collectively by Belgrade being forced into committing or executing a policy of ethnic segregation with all the crimes in the 1990s, I think we will not be able for a certain time period to have a Kosovo based on a civic nation model, but one that will have certain institutional positive discrimination guarantees for Serbs. Is that fair for Kosovo Albanians? No. Is there any other possibility? I would say no. That's just what I would say. There is no other way. In that sense, I would say the dialogue at the beginning, and I'm talking about the political dialogue, because the technical didn't lead anywhere, for good reasons. The political dialogue that started with German-British leadership, and German-British leadership, by the way, in 2010 already brought the technical dialogue, is well, not the EU as an institution, was a major step. However, this whole policy, which is not, you know, from a very fundamentalist principle, democracy theory-based approach, is not ideal. It had enormous strategic challenges from the beginning. And the EU is known not to be good on strategic challenges and having a strategic policy. And I would briefly try to list them. And I think we have lost strategic direction on all of them in the last 2 years. And I think that's why we have the crisis, both the inner political and the crisis of the dialogue. First one, the whole approach, probably there is no other, Spend may disagree and he may not like it, nobody may like it, to solving a status dispute between Serbia and Kosovo through EU integration process of Serbia is a highly sophisticated enterprise for the EU, has never been done before. And this really does not come from the institutions, it's come from what we had German, British leadership with the US support. So in order this to succeed, really you need enduring will and engagement. What we have, what did we get on this point in the last 3 years? We got something very interesting, the EU accession framework, negotiation framework document for Serbia. It basically says in one article that throughout the 34 chapters of negotiation of Serbia with the European Union to get a member state, the state of Kosovo, the territory, has to be cut out of the state of Serbia. This is a major thing, has not been recognized. Serbia is pretending it's not existing for good reason. Kosovo is not mentioning it either. Interesting, Kosovo government is a major success, but still, this remains a major enterprise. Second point, the main strategic question of what is the end point of the dialogue has not been defined so far by the key EU leaders. Is it Kosovo independence? Is it something less? Question not be answered by Germany nor Britain nor the US. Another question here, in the April agreement, Kosovo obliged itself in a written document, in a national agreement, to not block Kosovo's path to EU membership. How is that to be guaranteed? Because for sure Serbia is faster, it's going to get into the EU first. How can we fix this guarantee that Serbia that has entered the EU is not blocking Kosovo from becoming a member, you know? No answer so far from the EU. Another question. In order to solve the problem of the dialogue integration of the North, and we couldn't start it at least without Serbia, the EU couldn't. The EU had to let Serbia deeper into the state of Kosovo first. You had the Serb list with the first municipal votes. The Serb loyal party, the liberal party loyal to the Kosovo state in the south, disappeared. So we have Serbia directly in the Serbian government, directly within the government of Kosovo. This is something that could not be avoided, but you need a plan how to kick out Serbia on the midterm. There is no plan yet on the EU side. Fourth point, integration of the North. Yes, integration of judiciary and police that so far was part of Serbian state institution was perceived as a major key stumble block of integrating the North. However, this is only a precondition. This is not the real problem. The real problem in the North is that for years, for a decade and a half, it was a kind of Wild West, a rules-free environment in which police and judiciary were basically not doing their work. There's organized crime. There's every time when the police is trying to arrest somebody on base of organized crime, there is an organized mob preventing this. So integration police and judiciary and police into the Kosovo state was a major step. But how do you bring those police and judiciary against organized crime? And we have two major guys, the Veselinov brothers, of the major guys of the organized crime. They now run the SNS party, Vucic party in the north. How do you break this organized crime nexus? Who is there? Police is not used to do it. Kosovo Albanian side cannot do it. ULEX police basically dismantled with the recent mandate, and KFOR is saying they're not doing policing, so who is going to do it? Not solved. Finally, the last point. To have Serbia cooperative and the Serbian government and the Kosovo government, the PDK government, we have a democracy problem with both ruling parties. And we have been stumbling and having troubles for many years how to navigate both with the status problem on the one side and the democracy problem on the other side. We have not solved it, to the opposite. We have been trading in recent years through the dialogue democracy for solving the status dispute. And in a way, it is coming back to us. It's coming back to us with the political crisis in Kosovo, and it's coming back to us with the regime in Serbia very cooperative in the dialogue, because they must, under pressure, is becoming more and more authoritarian. Mm-hmm. So these are all the strategic questions that have not been solved, and that's why the dialogue is in a serious crisis, not because it's not ideal, not because, you know, it's not done by the EU institutions, but by certain leadership and coalition of the willing within the EU, but I think because we really, really have lost concentration, those key actors in the EU, concentration on the dialogue and strategic direction.
Thank you, Bodo, for this is almost a summary, but I also ein sehr Entschuldigung, jetzt muss ich wieder auf.
And I'm sorry I have to come back to German for a moment there.
Ich muss auf Deutsch reden, weil ich.
And I have to come back to German now. I'm asked to come back to German because there are some Germans in the audience, and I would like to invite them. And so many people can take the floor. You can also just comment. You don't have to ask a question, but please be brief, and please tell us your names. Tell us maybe whether you work for any institution. So as I can barely see because of the light shining in my face, I cannot guarantee I saw the first claim for the floor. There's somebody here, then I can see a couple of people in the back. So we'll start on on the right-hand side, please. Maybe, yes. So let's just collect some questions and comments. You start, and then we can take the 3, 4, 5 people in the back. So sorry. So please take the microphone away from the gentleman after he's taken the floor, so we can finish after 1 minute. So please hold the microphone. So you can take the floor in English or in German.
You were referring to the northern part of Kosovo. After the conclusion of the normalization agreement and the opening of the bridge, we went there, let's say the GIZ and I, and it was closed after several hours again, unfortunately. Then we have celebrated the inauguration of a tourist project. I took over a Kosovo diplomat. There were no other Kosovars invited to take part in the ceremony. And I said nastily to my colleague, to my Kosovo colleague, I'm sorry, Hans-Jochen Schmidt, I work there at the moment as an advisor for the foreign ministry. And I said, you know, I throw you now into a pool of sharks and you have to try to find your way. And how can the EU, how to say, sponsor project, a tourist project, and there is none of the Kosovars there?
Okay, thank you. Hier vorne, bitte. Also, das geht um die EU.
Okay, so this is all about the EU. Okay, we'll take the next question. So on the left-hand side, maybe? Just, you know, go ahead. I can't see the faces. Hello, I'm a journalist and political researcher. I have a question for Spend Ahmedi. I would like to tell you, just take the courage to take Mr. Tobias Flessen Kemper, that your name is not Spend, but Spend. He's not calling you by your right name. So I'm sorry, but I'm not Tobias. My name is Tobias also. Okay, but there are names like Solange, and they're called Solange in German, so there are also cases like that. So please tell him by his real name, call him by his real name. So all I wanted is to relax this debate. Well, we were speaking about tear gas, about churches, we were speaking about violence, and Tatiana Lazarevich said that the churches were built on the ruins of the Alban Catholic churches. But what you didn't say was nobody spoke about Lake Olmani, about the mines of Kshnitsa, nobody spoke about various places, various spa places, places that used to be the economic backbone of Kosovo, which could have created so many jobs. And one of the reasons for which Albanians from Kosovo leave the country. And secondly, I thought it was a shame that Ms. Lazarevich did a one-woman show here. I didn't think it was fair that she was trying to intervene on which flag Albanians would wear. So please do not interfere.
I would like to ask Ms. Lunacek what their idea of normalization is, while she knows that the Serbs raped over 40,000 people, 13,000 people were murdered, and 2,000 people are still missing. So how do you imagine normalization unilaterally will not work? And you are very much aware of that. I couldn't hear your name, sorry. Labinotr Moku. There's someone else. Let's walk through systematically, please. Vidvendosi activist.
Clarify two things. One, very importantly, the Ahtisaari agreement was a paper written with a quite extensive rights for the Serbian community in Kosovo. And it was compromise, the ultimate compromise in terms of having an internationally recognized the process and recognition of the Republic of Kosovo, and as Mr. Weber said, through the UN. And this was meant to be to go through a supervised process. This supervision ended in 2011, which meant that the Kosovo government has
completed all of its conditionalities within the process, which were also, to clarify, to form new municipalities that were majority Serb within Kosovo. This is a very important element to outline, because when I was listening to one of the panelists, one of the topics that were constantly being popped up was the idea of multi-ethnicity. This is instilled in the Ahtisaari package, with which I disagree. I disagree with the Ahtisaari package. But there is a contradiction, Mrs. Lazarevic. If you say multi-ethnicity, and then you want an association, a mono-ethnic association, one and the other don't go together. So you either want a multi-ethnic Kosovo for everybody else, and a mono-ethnic association only for the Serbs. This is a contradiction. And the second point that I would like to make, which is, I believe, also very important, the Republic of Kosovo is not failing as a state. As a matter of fact, it's thriving on the idea that there is finally an opposition that contradicts the idea of going and negotiating an agreement which is basically against the constitution 23 times without the parliament being involved at all. Mm-hmm. So what we are talking about is basically a thriving Kosovo and a thriving opposition fighting against a corrupt government that is negotiating without success.
Vielen Dank. Da die junge Dame mit der Brille und dann haben wir
the young lady with the specs over there, then we've got five, and then we'll have a short break, have the panel reflect on that, and then we'll continue with another round. Good evening. I'm Heinrich Böll Foundation Fellow Ami Mozartrone. I've got a question to Ms. Lazarevic. It was quite interesting to ask Spend Amity what flags are being worn in the protests. Very justified question. The institution you are representing, you did there some education work before the municipal elections for the Kosovo Serbs, and there the Serb flag was worn. Now, what was your contribution to remove that flag before a constitutional election? This is something I would think is a bit more important than what is being worn in terms of flags during a protest. Well, this is quite a number of questions. Some of you, Tatiana, some of the questions to the rest of the panel. Not everything has to be answered. I would like to give the floor to Tatiana Lazarevic first of all, and then I will gather the remaining questions.
I really wouldn't like to finish this evening again with the same feeling, one against all. I hear once again, I'm sorry, but I really would like, no, as a Kosovo Serb, this is kind of, you know, but that's, everyone is wearing his own cross. I really would once again recall, please don't forget once you leave this room, Kosovo Serbs at this moment are less than 5% of Kosovan society. Just think of the numbers. How can be 5% of one population the destabilizing factor that I'm getting and, you know, kind of feeling talking, you know, to you or others, like it's again the problem with us. To answer about the flags, very nice question, because I was also, why did I ask Mr. Ahmeti about the flag, is when he said that he wants a dialogue with the Serbs. If we are talking about the integration process, if it's true what the Vetvendosi is showing so far, that their value system and something that they are fighting for is the ethnic Albania, showing also through the symbols, through their posts, through their activism, I'm sorry, this is not the integration that I'm willing to be part of, you know. And I'm pretty sure you will not find a single Kosovo Serbs that will be, there is going to be part of this kind of integration. And at this moment, you know, the sophisticated part, you know, I'm talking to Albanians almost every day. And even those who are against the violence, when they're talking about the EU, they're thinking of the EU as all Albanian countries again in the EU together. So, you know, it's again this kind of ethnic question. A. So as for the Serbian flag, we are not in the same position. Please, and this is also connected to what Mr. Weber said, connected to the flags. Speaking of, you know, just to add one more point about three decades of the manipulation, please don't forget that there is something more than three decades of manipulation from Belgrade to Kosovo Serbs, which is at least 100 years of Serbian statehood. Don't forget the former country. Don't forget the Serbian state that has, without any kind of interruption, existing in Kosovo. I'm not going, even debating about the political issue. I'm talking about our everyday life. This was our natural system. These were the institutions that we exercise our loyalty, at least over 100 years. So we cannot switch overnight. You know, if you have that power, understandably, to remove the leaders overnight, you have to understand that when it comes to populace, we are not part of politicians to change, you know, our deeds overnight. But as people, we need time to compensate, to digest the changes. And you cannot in six months all of a sudden to, you know, do this brainwash with the entire Kosovo Serbian population and tell them, hey, wait, you woke up in another country and let's immediately take Kosovan flag. So if we feel, you know, at this moment, to me it's more understandable why Kosovo Serbs would have a Serbian flag in Kosovo than why Vetven Dosje, the mayor of Pristina, belonging to a movement, would have any problem to take a Kosovan flag, because this is the country that, you know, Albanians after 1999 have started building. So to me it's completely normal to, one more thing about the constitution, you know, things. Please don't forget that this dialogue between Belgrade and Pristina is not the dialogue of the constitutional courts when it comes to association. It was supposed to be the dialogue on the top level of political elites and when it comes to digestion of normalization between two people. Unfortunately, we don't see dialogue between two people. If it had been a dialogue between the constitutional court before the constitutional court of Kosovo and the association, the constitutional court of Serbia, let me remind you, has ruled out, you know, calling anti-constitutional a set of packages from Brussels, official record, much before the constitutional of court has ruled out, you know, parts of association. So we are not talking about the dialogue of constitutional court, and this part, I agree, it's part of abnormality, but this is kind of flexibility that Belgrade and Pristina agreed to exercise in order to normalize the relations.
To keep this here a bit under control and give some time. There was a question as well related, I think, to environment and industry, which I think largely falls under the European remit as well, in terms of creating perspectives.
Well, the one thing when you asked about the different areas, I mean, I remember when I went to visit Stripce and was shown by the Serb mayor there, who spoke also Albanian, which I really appreciated, because I think that would be something that both Serbs and Albanians in Kosovo should try to speak each other languages. Many of the, not the younger ones, but the older Kosovo Albanians speak Serb still, but hardly any Serbs speak Albanian, which I think there should be also in school system with both languages. That would help a lot. But apart from that, there in Stripce and the Brezovica, I think that is a project where also on tourism that really can help a lot, and where the Serb community there, the majority community, at least to my knowledge, and I do not speak either language, unfortunately, neither Serb nor Albanian, but there is some efforts to move ahead and have that something where also jobs are being created. But I'd like to also refer to two other issues that were mentioned. The one with the association agreement. You know, when that whole debate started, I didn't really understand, also from the EU side, why you could not just use the already existing statutes of the Kosovo Association of Kosovo Municipalities that has been existing for a long time, in order to simply, also for the Kosovo Albanians, to invite the Kosovo Serbs to participate there and then work together, because that's what municipal work is about, to work to help citizens in education, in health, in streets, in sewage systems, all that you are doing in Pristina. Yeah? So that for me would have been the natural thing to do. Well, what we have now is unfortunately a two thing. We have the one for the Kosovo Albanian municipalities, supposedly, although it isn't mentioned like that, it could be with the Kosovo Serb municipalities as well, and the one that is being implemented, hopefully, at one time for the Kosovo Serbs. And I perfectly agree with all of those, and I found it a good process that the Kosovo Constitutional Court was asked to give its opinion on that. Yes, and there were quite a few things that the Kosovo Constitutional Court said. Well, the principles say this, some things we cannot agree with, but in the law and the statute that is to be done, that can be done in a way that's according to the Kosovo Constitution. And that should be done now, from the parliament as well, and with the parliament. Well, that's my opinion on that. I think that would be a good thing to do. And because, Tatiana, you've been saying that, yes, you're less than 5%. That's true, but according to the Kosovo Constitution, and you said it yourself, I mean, you have almost 10% of members of the parliament, 10 fixed seats. You've got two ministers and one deputy prime minister. In the parliament, the Kosovo Serbs even gave the quorum to having Mr. Thaci elected as president. So use that as your sort of feelings. I also regret that SLS, the former Liberal Party, is hardly existing anymore, because they were really on the Kosovo side, yeah, and didn't always look to Belgrade. And I think that should change. And for the municipal elections, I was there in, when were the last, the municipal elections in the north? Thank you, yeah. I also, I mean, I was there as observer, so we had all the ballot that only had the Serbian insignia on it. I hope that next time, when it's done now, there should be the Kosovo flag on it. Because I've been trying to talk with some of the mayors as well. I was there with a KFOR delegation, and they had agreed that one of the mayors in the north would also want to meet with me, because I wanted to meet with him. And then we were standing there, he was in his garden somewhere, but I could see him, he could see me, but then he said he didn't want to talk to me. I have been criticizing also the Kosovo government for not, also in the past, the last one, for not reaching out to Kosovo Serbs as much as they should have done. Yeah? So I think there that needs more. But if you say that, yes, you're only less than 5%, yes, that's true right now, but you have, with Belgrade, a very strong power in the, also in the region, and also to the EU on your side, yeah? And that, I think, makes it more difficult for Kosovo Albanians to accept some things that are being postulated right now. And I think you should also try to see it that way.
Spend. As we have 14 minutes left, 1 minute for Spend. 1 minute for Bodo.
Why do I always have 1 minute only?
Another round of questions. But you have to, don't do it too much ping pong now, I think.
No, it's not ping pong. Vedvendosje has never, if you find me one public statement where any official of Vedvendosje said that we want ethnic Albania, I think, you know, I would resign, I can say that now. We never said that, so again I told you not to speak about Vedvendosje through somebody else's words. Don't do that, because it's not good. Ask Vedvendosje about what they say about our positions, and it's very clear. Second, I hear in the audience as well, there is no parallel between me as a mayor and a mayor of a Kosovo Serb municipality in the north in terms of the flag. I have different issues with the flag. I respect it. But the issue there is because the people of Kosovo did not vote for the flag. That's the basic democracy question. I love the Republic. I love my country. I want to make it stronger. I fight for it every day. While a Serb mayor does not accept it, doesn't want it to make it work, and as you said, it still lives under the impression of previous Yugoslavia and hopes that it will come back. There is a major difference there, you know, and it's a difference of approach in general about what you do. Tatiana said, I think, about 7 times that it's 5% of the population. Is it democratic that 5% of the population can block 95% of the will of the people? Is it democratic? We cannot create an army because the 5% does not want it. We cannot change the constitution because the 5% does not allow it. We cannot change the most important laws because the 5% does not allow it. So we are not making the 5% more important than it is. The way the Ahtisaari agreement was written made it more important than it was. And again, Ahtisaari was a way, and this is why I said that, you know, there is now turmoil in Kosovo, because we accepted the Ahtisaari package as a price for Serbia to recognize Kosovo. Did not happen. We took on the Ahtisaari approach. Now we say again negotiations, where we start from the Ahtisaari and Serbia starts from where it was. And again, we have to meet in the middle of that. When is this going to end? Are we going to have, sorry, 2, 3, 4 associations, this, that, so that it never ends for our country, so that we can work on our goals, which is fighting corruption and economic development? Just to end with the Constitutional Court, I don't think it's the job of Constitutional Court to tell you what else you should do politically. The question was, is this agreement in violence of the Constitution? They said yes, but now nobody asked them what should we do next, because it's not a political question that the Constitution should, Constitutional Court should say. Bodo was saying he likes to see Kosovo as a citizen state. He doesn't believe in it. I am a little bit more idealistic, Bodo. He knows that. I don't see it overnight. I see it maybe in 10 years, 15 years, but I'd like to fight for it and work for it. You know, I really believe that it could happen. I see it every day. So you can tell me today it's not possible because how the EU is functioning, but really I see it happening. At the end of the day, EU, I think, and Ulrike, I think, knows best, the foreign policy of the EU, when they have to ask 28 countries, at the end becomes a very weak foreign policy that has to say to Serbia, yes, but yes, you know, we agree, but we have to disagree. To Kosovo, yes, we agree because there are 5 non-recognizers, there is Germany, there is that. At the end, it's not a strong policy that tells you how there's always this weak solution that is pushed in order just to pass to the next day. Mm-hmm. We're asking the EU to be braver and say these are the approaches if we want longer-term solutions.
Okay, I'll be a bit brave here with your expensive expansion minutes. The minutes become bigger and bigger. Bodo, very quickly in the last round, please prepare yourself. I saw the gentleman here. Okay, okay, then it's 2 on this left side and 1, 2, 3 here. So we have 5 more people.
Okay, let me try to be brief and tap into the Constitutional Court thing, because I think that that's important to understand the current mess. Look, the April 2013 agreement, according to Serbian constitutional lawyers and not regime conformist lawyers, is at least a de facto recognition of the independence of Kosovo by Serbia and maybe even de jure. So that's the first point. Second point, there were statements, Spent, you may not remember, immediately after the agreement was signed. And this was with the strong message, which came at the beginning, I repeat, that Kosovo is gone. That was the Merkel message to Belgrade. And you need to recognize it, otherwise you will not get into the EU. There were statements by Dacic, Vucic, saying exactly what you said, Spend, were not said. They said, Kosovo is gone. We could only return it by army. And there's nobody in our country who is prepared to do that. So the thing we need to do, not finished, is to see how we can make life of Kosovo Serbs better. So, but what happened then, you know, strategically with this? Veteran Dosje tried to bring the April agreement to the Constitutional Court in Kosovo. The Constitutional Court decided that this is not admissible. 2 years later, you brought the August 25 agreement to the Constitutional Court. The president was it, but based on your opposition process, otherwise it would not have ever entered the Kosovo court. And there's another thing. The Kosovo court, constitutional court, assessed that this request is admissible, though the August 25 agreement, quote, is not a legal document. Now, why is this? Both decisions to declare the first, trying to assess whether the April agreement is in line with the Kosovo constitution, and they rejected this. And this admissibility decision, the positive one, last December, they were both based on the fact, and this is one of our big failures on the rule of law, these constitutional courts in all decisions linked to the dialogue and in many other political ones, they judge politically. The constitutional court is not free of political assessments. And there we get into the problem. Constitutional court, and I finish in 30 seconds, takes one political decision to not look into whether the April agreement is in line with the Constitution. It takes another one, whether the August 25 agreement is in line with the Constitution. And it takes a middle road between the political pressure and the constitutional law. It basically says that part of these provisions of an agreement that was originally, listen to this, drafted by the European External Action Service is not in line with the Constitution. So there's a problem. And on the other end, and that's my last sentence, the statements we heard in beginning of 2014 from Serbian government officials, we have never heard again. Since then, we hear that the April agreement is status neutral. And there you see how we lost strategic direction.
All right, thank you very much. So now, really briefly, you have 30 seconds each. I mean.
My name is Erdoğan Hatkotsiri. I'm a political, studied political science. I think I'll go on with Mrs. Lazarevic. She mentioned many times that the Serbians in Kosovo are having troubles, are suffering a lot, and that they are only less than 5%, so they cannot make a real change. One thing she mentioned was that some Serbs were not allowed to go to church for their prayers, so they were having some kind of obstacles. Okay. But on the other side, you kind of missed to mention the fact that the Serbian one came with 12 kilogram TNT and tried to blow up the entire cathedral in Pristina.
Okay. No, but it's... Is there anything you want to ask as a question, or was it now the comment? Okay, then please quickly the question. The question starts with a W.
So what about stuff like this? You never mentioned that a lot of them are trying to be obstacles instead of trying to integrate in our system.
Thank you. Next one was there. Okay. Next one was here.
I'm Aaron Zinulahu, and I'm a student in a school here in Berlin. And I first want to talk to Tatiana Lazarevic. I'm the Serb about what Tatiana talked about, the activism at the Parliament of Kosovo. I think that at this kind of events, we don't have to begin with the problems, but we have to try to find the solutions of the problems and how we go on onto this issue. And to Lunacek, to the statement of Lunacek that you need to have a good image. I think that before you need to have a good image, you need to have an uncorrupted state.
Thank you. I think there was now two on this side. I don't remember, as I can't really see. Don't give the microphone away.
Good evening. Drivalda Delia is my name, a student of International Relations and East European Studies. My question is actually to all of you. There is a tendency, general tendency, to name call the opposition, Vedvendosia, as ethnically nationalist. It happened this evening, but it happens with the international actors in Kosovo as well. So to what extent do you think this is a constructive way of going about finding a discussion with the opposition and actually taking seriously their cause? To what extent this name calling, do you think actually affects negatively the image of Kosovo and the opposition itself? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. There was one more there, if I remember, or withdrew, and there's a gentleman in the middle. And now I'm... Okay, the person there withdrew, it seems.
Okay.
These are the rules of the house.
I'm Libona Liu, I'm from Pristina, but by origin I'm from Preševa, and I just wanted to raise an issue that we are talking here about normalization between Kosovo and Serbia, and always a topic in this process always is only Serbs in Kosovo, while there is never a topic about the rights of Preševa, Benos, and Albanians that lives in Preševa, Benos, and Medveđa. And I know that probably you are informed that the population in this area has always getting, in a way, expelled from there, and we have now more than less than 50% of what have been in 2000 of population. Maybe this is looked through the stability aspect, because very soon that region is going to be closed up. Nobody's going to live there anymore, and I think in which kind of normalization process of Serbia the right of Albanians and in these three municipalities can be a topic and become a topic.
Thank you very much for coming back to the issue back there. Now, my wonderful panelists will perform a wonder and pick up some elements of the questions that were raised and answer literally in 1 minute. 1 minute, just to remind everyone, is 60 seconds and not 62 or 65 or 70. So, spend 1 minute for you. Tatiana, Bodo, and the Feinerberg to
Ulrike. No chance in 1 minute to address everyone, but I will say in the past that Vendosia has been called communist, Islamist, anti-Islamist, atheist, now extremist, nationalist, all kinds of isms that exist, we've been called. And steadily from 5% in 2007-08, that Vendosia is growing to more than 20%. Because it is addressing the questions that people are talking about, and ignoring that Vendosia means ignoring more and more the Kosovo youth and the Kosovo public. I think it's finally time that Vendosia is respected for what it represents, so that it brings to the table what it can in order to reach a better future for Kosovo. So I hope this goes as a message to listen to us, to talk to us. We will listen to all of the actors that come, but we have the Pristina perspective. We cannot look at it from Brussels or Berlin.
Thank you. Tatiana?
As for this Mr. Gavrić case, I didn't mention that case because then I would have mentioned a number of other incidents, and we clearly have no time for something like that. Those are completely two separate things. Actually, they're not incidents. Gavrić is not Kosovo Serb. Gavrić is, as far as I, to my knowledge, what I know from the press, he was a smuggler from Belgrade, you know, and it's very, very, I talked recently on journalistic issues with his lawyers, it's a very controversial issue, and it's still not, it's not proved that he was trying to, you know, blow up the cathedral. He was only arrested in the area where the cathedral was, but at the same time, you could say the American embassy. So there was like smuggling of explosives, another issue. If I had mentioned, then I would have mentioned why the Serbian village was shot, why the other church a couple of days ago was looted, and then we would go on and on. So those are like two things. And why I mentioned that, that particular case, because I wanted to show that as a sign of goodwill, although I do agree that the head of the Srpska Lista politically was kind of self-suicide to say for someone that someone is savage because he banned the Serbian religious to go to church. You could have used other words in other way to show in a very moderate way to criticize. I do agree with that. I still think that the responsibility of Kosovo, like Vet Vendosia and other Kosovo Albanians, was okay, here is this clumsy Serb for the first time coming to our parliament. Let's talk to him first before we take all, you know, majority of people pouring out on the street and trying, doing this kind of massive protest. It was very threatening message to the rest of the Serbs. That's why I mentioned that.
This
you
is
know.
The
and
minute.
Yes.
This is the minute.
Okay. 2 points in 30 seconds each. Listen, there's a mistrust. Is that functioning?
Yes, it is.
There's a mistrust in the EU and the US because you mentioned Bosnia. We put together a Dayton Agreement, which was to last for 3-4 years because it was not for a functional state. And now it's 20 years, it's still there, and the EU is pretending that it's not for us responsibility to fix it or remove it. The dialogue can function, but it needs a strategic redirection. It needs the following, in my opinion. We need to go to a point, we need to ask Serbia to recognize Kosovo at a certain point when the new government is in. And the second point is, and we need to have a plan when UN membership for Kosovo will be on the dialogue. And the last point is, we should not compromise over democracy and the rule of law on the dialogue, because then it won't function. And then it can be done within the framework, not this agreement of August 25, but in a kind of combination, some collective ethnic rights for Serbs, which you may not like, and strong local self-governments, because we did not speak at all about local self-governments. It speak on the Serb side, it speak on Albanian side, and that's typical for trading democracy, for resolving the status dispute. That's key. It can be done within that framework, but it needs to be done seriously. Last point, pressure war. Kosovo has been used for 2.5 decades by Serbia as a scapegoat to avoid decentralization of Serbia. Serbia needs to get rid of Kosovo and to decentralize, and it needs to regionalize. And in that framework, you need to solve the issue of pressure war and Vojvodina.
Thank you. Ulrike.
Yeah, I can just continue on the point on pressure war that you raised. In our reports, also on Kosovo and on the one on Serbia, the issue of decentralization in Serbia is also an important point. But what you are very right with, and I mentioned that with people who do the dialogue at the EU level, that pressure will needs to be something that also needs to be addressed in this process. The other thing I remember when the time when the Vendosje decided to become a party, yeah, which it hasn't been all the time. It was a movement before, and still is somehow. But then I remember, because of the issue of Greater Albania in whatever texts and words, etc., quite a few of EU officials didn't want to talk to Vete Vendosje. I always told them, don't do that. Yeah, I mean, the only way to know and to understand why they are doing what they're doing is to talk with them. So finally they're doing it, at least some of them. So I think that is also important to see, even though I don't like the idea of Great Albania either, but that's not the main point for me in the process where we are now. Now, because you, the student here, raised again the issue with the image. I insist that apart from the fight against corruption is a big part in the reports we do in the European Parliament, but I insist, especially in the situation we have in the European Union, please look at situations we're having here and the problems we are. So being realistic, I also think the image of the country is also important. It's not the only thing, but it's also important if we want to move forward together. Last thing, constitutional courts. Yes, constitutional courts take decisions sometimes that can be seen as political, like it or not. Well, I'm in Germany here. There was a decision of the German Constitutional Court considering the European Parliament is not a real parliament. That's why we don't need a threshold there. But we have it for the national parliament. That is seen by me as a political decision as well. So I'm not defending all the decisions of constitutional courts, not in my home country either. But the one on the association in Kosovo, I would like also the Kosovo parliament with all its members to use it and to make something out of it that makes sense. Last thing, European Union is not magic and not a magician. That's why I also, with all the criticism I have, I also think the dialogue is something that makes sense, but it has to be done with more reporting on the implementation at all levels and to citizens, and there has to be more dialogue between citizens inside Kosovo, and I hope, Spend, you will go and visit Tatjana in Mitrovica and talk with the other Serbs and invite her to see the Serbs in Pristina, etc., etc., because without that, nobody at the top level will reach really more understanding and acceptance of each other and moving forward. Thank you.
Dankeschön.
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you so much. Just let me briefly say one thing. You have to hold on for one more second. Thanks so much to our panelists for the discipline normalization of relations between Serbia and Kosovo. That was the topic of this evening. We might not have covered everything. There would have been so much to cover, but there's one thing we have, a prospect of detention and relaxation. We're invited for some snacks downstairs and some drinks. So please sign your names on the attendance list out there, register there so this can be continued in the future. And I think after this evening, we will all know that there's still so much to discuss as we speak about Kosovo and Serbia. Thank you.